Welcome back to Sakima's Ridge Homestead. Today's video is another one of our community event classes. This is a rather lengthy class. John and Kris talk about different kinds of gear, some of the things we recommend, some of the things we don't. I do have to apologize. I got a new camera, and unbeknownst to me, the camera shuts off every 20 minutes of recording, so there are tiny little bits that are missing in what John's saying. Nothing important is lost, but there's a couple little spots where the video will jump. That's because the camera shut off and I had to restart it real quick. So other than those few little blips and the fact that this is a rather lengthy video, it's chock full of really important information, so I hope you enjoy it. Hello, and welcome to our channel.
We're glad you're here.
Hello, everyone, and welcome to our first This Time This Year community event meeting. We're going to go over some gear today at the request of a bunch of members. We did a gear class, I think 2 years ago, something like 2 years ago, and we're going to revisit a bunch of stuff. We're going to revisit it in a little bit more in-depth way, so we're going to be here for a little while. I'm John. Everyone here knows me, but those of you that might be listening online, I'm the firearms instructor for the group. This is Kris, he's my nephew. He helps me with the firearms instruction. He's also the range officers. So today, we're going to go over first line, second line, and third line gear. We're not going to go over third line so much because we do that with our bug out trainings and our bug out bag stuff. That's mostly what the third line is. And the lines are set up kind of as a prioritization of your gear and how your gear in theory should be set up and what kinds of things you want on a different line to serve. So, I have everything written down here to make it sound fancier. So the whole purpose of the first line, second line, and third line system is surviving, carrying out the mission, and staying operational. So when we talk about that, it sounds awfully tactical. And we're a preparedness group, right? So it's like, why are we talking about tactical stuff in a preparedness group? Well, the reason why, in my opinion, it's important to have these things and know how to use them and know about these things is because we have the Second Amendment of the Constitution. The Second Amendment of the Constitution specifies a well-regulated militia, which doesn't say what a well-regulated militia is. If you take it into the context of what it was when they formed the Constitution at the beginning of the country, a well-regulated militia was the people. And it just meant that they had the gear, the equipment, and the training necessary to do what they needed to do to defend their communities, their country, as private citizens. That's what it meant, and that's what it still means today. So as being a responsible private citizen, you should be capable, if you're able-bodied and willing, to defend the nation in times of crisis. And if you're going to do that, you should probably know what you're doing and have the right gear to do so, which is why we do some of the more advanced training and stuff we do here instead of just the regular personal defense training. So that being said, your first line of gear is basic stuff. And we're going to go over this in two ways. We're going to start with the tactical gear, and then we're going to go into like how it applies to daily carry and stuff. We're going to go over the daily carry section after we go over all of the more tactical gear. The first line is always survival. It's the basic equipment that enables you to survive and forms the foundation for the other lines. You never move anything away from your first line, and this line consists of gear closest to you that you always carry with you. It includes anything that you're wearing at the time, anything you're carrying in your pockets, anything you have attached to your belt, and normally includes, assuming that you live in a state like we do, that you can carry a concealed carry firearm or some ways to defend yourself, all right? Now, when you apply that to a tactical situation, you're talking about the things that you need to stay alive in case everything else goes wrong. So we're gonna go over that in the first line. And then the second line is gonna be carrying out the mission. The second line can vary depending on what exactly you're going to be planning on doing. Obviously, someone that is planning on being a shotgunner is going to have a completely different load-bearing vest or plate carrier setup than someone that's going to be a rifleman or a marksman. We're going to be talking about general purposes here and for individual home defense and self-defense and defense of your community. So we're going to be talking in generalities, not in specialties. So we're not going to be talking about any mission-specific gear here. We're just going to be talking in generalities, if that makes any sense to everyone. It's going to include the gear that the individual has on when carrying out any kind of defensive mission that you may have, and can be removed when you have to remove it if you have to get out of a bad situation or if you become so damaged or snagged on something or anything, you can just shed it and keep operating and surviving with just your belt. Then your third line is what keeps you operational out in the field. So, for instance, when we talk about bugging out, what keeps you operational when you're bugging out? Your bug out bag. So it's all your extra supplies and everything that keeps you operational for a long period of time, not something that has your immediate needs in it. So it can include a backpack, a rucksack, a duffel bag, a bag. It can even include a vehicle or another means of transportation. If you got pack animals, if you got some other ways that you can haul the stuff with you, but it's all the other stuff that you have in reserve and not actively on your person. All right. Now, the main principle to this three lines process is that you divide the equipment on these three lines so they complement each other. The gear you need is always accessible during your most critical times, and the gear that is in reserve is the stuff that you keep back and don't necessarily need all the time. All right. So, in theory, even in a bed situation where you're operating a bug out situation or whatever, you should have a field of operations or a home base set up of some sort, somewhere that you can go back to and replenish your supplies at some point. Consider that where you're going to be storing your third line gear if you're going to be operating out in the field or something, or if you're going to be transporting your field of operation from one place to another, that's when you're going to be bringing your third line with you. Does that make sense to everyone? So for today's class, we're going to focus on first line and second line gear. First line gear, when we're talking about this kind of stuff, is going to be your belt system. Now, before I go into details about what I have on mine and what Kris has on his, we're going to talk about some generalities on what you would typically find in a typical first line kit. All right? You're going to have a firearm. It's either going to be your rifle or your handgun. It can be both. It's going to be part of your front line kit or first line kit. You're going to have a knife of some sort. It doesn't need to be any kind of special knife or anything, just a knife. Even if it's something that you're carrying in your pocket, it's a folding knife or something, it can be a knife. Some type of basic fire making tool, some type of basic survival kit, a map, compass, GPS, depending on your area of operations. If you're around here and you're familiar with the area, you might not have a map on you, but if you're going to be somewhere that you're not familiar with, or you're going to be traveling or something, you're going to want to acquire maps for all the places there and in between, and keep it on you at all times. Equipment for taking notes and note-taking, some type of illumination, emergency rations, eye protection, ear protection, spare magazines for your handgun, and at least one spare magazine for your main gun, some type of non-lethal, such as a pepper spray, telescopic baton, handcuffs, or some kind of implementation to subdue someone if needed, some type of tourniquet or Israeli bandage, and a basic first aid kit. And a dump pouch. Alright? So, what are all these things and what do they look like? So, for my current setup right now, obviously I'm a competitive shooter. I don't do anything ridiculous in the field, or I'm not a police officer or anything like that, so I don't need any of the compliance items to say. I have telescopic batons and everything in case I ever really need them. I just don't typically keep them on my kit. It's going to be more of a mission-specific thing for me. My belt, I carry three extra mags for the handgun. I have my holster, which normally has a handgun in it, which I don't have in there right now because we were playing it with it a little bit earlier. That actually had my flashlight on it, so it had a flashlight on the actual handgun itself. A basic little 3-inch fixed blade, just for basic needs, nothing particularly fancy or anything. Dump pouch. Mine is a quick deploy dump pouch. It's not deployed all the time. It's very easy and fast to deploy. Two extra rifle mags. First aid kit. This one's built up to be a buddy pack. Basically, it's two tourniquets, two Israeli bandages, and a bunch of other small first aid stuff that you might need to help another person. Or if you needed to use it on yourself, I guess you could, but you have an eye pack for that on your second line, which I'm going to talk about in a minute. Eye protection. When you're talking about eye protection, you want something ballistics rated. It doesn't necessarily need to be glass, it doesn't necessarily need to be expensive, but if you can get your hands on something ballistics rated, fog proof, and shields the side of your eye, those are the most important aspects of the eye protection you're going to be looking for. So I'm using X-Aegis eye protection because it has replaceable lenses, and in my long experience as a shooter, those lenses go bad very quickly as stuff hits them, and they become discolored from all the anti-fog stuff you put on them all the time, so being able to replace the lenses very quickly and easily is very beneficial. I use axle in the ear hearing protection. You can also use large out the ear hearing protection if you want to grab those walkers over there. Either one would really work. I prefer these because they're electronic, which means that they're noise canceling. So you can hear someone talk even while other loud things are happening. They cancel out anything over a certain decibel rating, while you can still hear everything else under that, so you can keep your situational awareness while everything else is going on. These have Bluetooth, so you can hook them up to like a phone or something if you're going to be doing something with having to hook it up to a phone. Like if you can run like a Zello or something through the phone and have it go through these. And I've tried that before and it works. They don't do radios though, so that's the one big disadvantage of these. So these are going to be more if you're only operating solo, or if you're going to be operating in a very big small room. Something like this has the benefit of having an external communication thing. So this has a walkie-talkie. Some of them, like Peltors, they actually plug in your radio so that you can hook up your radio to your headset and actually talk to people over several miles at a time. These ones are just set up for walkie-talkie and were actually just brought to my attention earlier today, and they're actually pretty nifty. Disadvantages to the out the ear instead of the in the ear. The out the ear are generally rated for lower decibel readings. So if you're going to be using short-barreled rifles or full-caliber rifles indoors or something, you're still going to probably be suffering hearing damage because they're only good for reducing it by about 20 to 25 decibels. The in the ear are good for anywhere from 30, 35 to 40 decibel reduction because they close off the ear canal much better. Some people use a combination of the two. I think that's a little overkill. I've been using these for years, and yeah, I have a little bit of deafening issues going on, but it's not because of these. It's because sometimes we shoot without hearing protection for training and stuff. But for the most part, these do their job pretty well, and you don't got to worry about it. What do you have on your first line, Kris?
It's not too much different than yours, except I have all-in-one for my three rifle mags and three pistol mags, and my dump pouch is always folded out. And I have kind of like a general purpose thing, but it also holds water too. I have a little admin pouch right here. It's got a couple pockets on it. Where my IFAC would be, that's in my trunk. And then I have a little pouch for tourniquet, and then my holster, and then my knife. So that's pretty much the only difference on mine.
It's an admin pouch. We're gonna add
it. It's just a little one for some small things.
So going into some details on the first line kit, now that we went over the generalities, why do you want a dump pouch?
Can anyone ask you what is a dump pouch?
That's a good thing. That's going to be the first thing I'm over, because most normal people don't know what a dump pouch is or why it's there. All right. So first, I'm going to ask the audience, what is a dump pouch? Does anyone know? No one? So a dump pouch is a pouch that you have on your belt that allows you to store your magazines. If you're going to be operating in the field and reloading on the fly, performing tactical reloads and such, the first place, you're not going to be stuffing it back in your carrier or stuffing it back on your belt because that takes too much time. You're going to be taking your mag and putting it in a dump pouch. My dump pouch can hold 7 AR mags. Wow. You want it to hold quite a bit, but you don't want it to be too big and be cumbersome. But they can also be used to carry things, like if you're going to be gathering or finding things, if you're going to be out and about, I don't know, maybe in your survival situation, finding mushrooms or something. You can also use it as an admin pouch if you need to. But the primary purpose of it is to be able to store your magazines quickly, and then be able to perform your inventory management or admin duties later afterwards, not during an actual firefight. So a couple other things I'll point out for your first line kit. Notice how my magazines on my first line kit don't have any type of active retention. Your first line kit is for emergency situations. You're not pulling from these unless bad things are happening. So bad things are happening, you need a magazine now. That's when you're pulling from these magazines. These aren't designed to be standard tactical reload magazines. These are designed to be speed reload magazines. So you want to be able to get to them quickly. You want to set up your plate carrier, which we're going to talk about in a little bit, so that you can access these without them anything being in the way of getting to them. They're the oh my god, I need a mag now kind of mags. All right? So remember, everything about the first line is about absolute necessity. The belt itself, I went with G-code holsters, but you can go with any kind of nice rigid belt. This is a two-part belt system. There's several different kinds of belt systems that you can go with, but I like the two parts because I feel like they give you good rigid retention. They don't move when you draw. You don't have an issue with them falling down or anything as long as you can get them on and size them properly. They're not just tension. They're actual Velcro that attaches to your internal belt that you cover up your belt loops and everything. He has an internal belt right here.
That's the same belt.
It makes it so that it's a much more secure connection since you have so much weight on your belt. That way you're running as fast as you can, going full sprint, and you're not losing gear all over the place. It's not jumping around and everything. A nice, secure buckle is always important. You'd be surprised with how often I see people's buckles snap or break under the weight of their belts, especially when they're running through tubes or crawling through cars or something. A mag gets snagged on a car seat or something, next thing you know, their whole belt rips off. You don't want to have that happen. Because remember, this is your first line. This is the stuff that you survive with. If you lose this, you're going to have a real bad time with things.
What brand is that again?
This is a G-code. You can get different brands, and there's other types. Like I said, this one's a two-part system. You can get one-part systems with MOLLE attachments, which a lot of people go with. They go outside your currently existing belt, but they don't attach to anything. They're friction fit, so you make them nice and tight, and they just stay there. Those can vary. I've seen good ones, and I've seen bad ones. I've seen ones with plastic buckles that are kind of like the buckles that you would buckle on like a backpack or something, and they just snap like they're not even there. And I've seen them with the nice interlocking buckles like this one, and they work pretty decently. But again, a lot of people that I see draw from the holster on them, it kind of moves around a lot on them and everything. So I prefer these ones. They're a little bit more pricey, but you get what you pay for. You know what I mean? Coming around, the knives don't need to be anything too fancy in your first line. Your first line is a survival knife, not a fighting knife. So you're mostly looking for something that you can use to do anything you would need to do with a knife. Cut rope, any random menial task. So with a 3-inch fixed blade, you should be able to get any job done that you need to get done. I went with G-code again for my holster mounting system. It uses an RCI attachment hardpoint. So the reason why I went with that is because there's a million different types of holsters and holster attachment systems out there, right? You got all the ones that you can buy at the Walmarts and the Targets and everything. You got the ones that you can buy at the mom and pop gun stores. But the ones that work the best are the ones that have an independent mounting system, not integral to the holster, and have an independent holster is what I've found. Now, you need a good mounting point because, again, running through doors at full speed, crawling through cars, doing all kinds of crazy stuff that you never thought you'd be doing with a gun attached to your belt, they get snagged on things very easily, and you can't be running through a doorway, smacking your holster, and having your whole holster rip off your belt, which I have seen happen. I've never had that issue with these, and I'm a 340-pound person that can run full speed through a door, smack my gun a million times, never had it fly off, never had it break. It's a very convenient attachment system, and you can switch out holsters for different firearms very quickly and easily. And for a matter of convenience, if we're not talking about tactical gear, you can equip all your holsters with the same mounting system. You can put one of these in your car, you can put one of these in your nightstand, you can put one of these in your gun room, in your safes, and you can just mount guns already in their holsters everywhere, using the same system. It's very convenient, very easy, highly recommend it. Lots of holster manufacturers are starting to manufacture holsters that use the RTI hardpoint attachment systems. Some still don't, but most of them can be converted to it if you don't have one that already has it. And again, with the Buddy Fac, it also has an RTI hardpoint attachment. But my Buddy Fac, this is not stuff for you. This is stuff in case you need to use it on someone else. So inside of here, you got sterile gauze pads, two sets of gloves, Band-Aids, Tylenols, antiseptic wipes, gauze tape, two tourniquets, Israeli bandage, everything that you would need to plug a hole if you need to plug a hole real quick or to treat some kind of minor issue. Maybe you have a headache or something out in the field, you take a couple of Tylenol, you're good to go, right? You always want some kind of secondary minor first aid kit that's not your IFAC. The IFAC is for the hardcore stuff. And that pretty much summarizes the first line gear. Do you have anything to add or anything up your pouch that you want to go over that I didn't have on mine that you want to go over?
The only thing different from mine that I would add is a spare thing on your belt to put water in. You can never have enough water.
I agree with that.
That's another thing dump out is for. I've used it for keeping water bottles and stuff in too. If you're drinking a water bottle and gotta go, you turn your dump out.
One thing that I've learned over the last few years, I first started with a buddy pack that does not, you can't remove it from your belt, it's like permanently affixed to your belt. Those suck. Makes it a lot easier to use them in bad situations. Over here, my quick deploy dump pouch, you can kind of see, it's not as big as his, but it gets pretty big from a little thing. It's an Expedition roly-poly. You can get different sizes, but man, it doesn't need to get anyone here in that. Anyone else have anything additional to share for your first line? No? Alright, then let's get these first lines out of here and get our second. This can be a chest rig, a load-bearing vest, or a day pack that can contain some of the following items. And again, I'm going to go over generalities and we're going to talk about what's in our kits and some specifics and recommended gears. So, a water reservoir. You need water. Water is a very important thing. If you're going to be out there for a day or two, you're going to need lots of water. So, we'll go over our specifics in a minute. But some type of night equipment or night vision equipment, including flashlights, chem lights, things like that. Something so that you can see in the dark. IFAC. What does IFAC stand for? Individual First Aid Kit. IFAC. Radios or other means of communication. If you're operating in an environment that would necessitate it, you want something warm, like a warm jacket or something to put over yourself for a poncho or something. Food for the duration of when you're going to be out in the field. So obviously you're not carrying your third line with you. If you're going to bring something out there, like if we're going to be out there doing training exercises and stuff for the next 12 hours, everything that you would want for breakfast, lunch, and dinner, it's going to be in your kit. This would include your mission-specific items. So your first line is more about survival. Your load-bearing vest, plate carrier, or day pack is going to have your mission-specific items if you're going out to complete a specific task. Some type of entry tool, some type of less than lethal compliance tools, a general purpose pouch, which can contain anything from gun cleaning kits, compact binoculars, cable ties, tape, more chem lights, fire making tools, etc. And if you're running light, at least 3 to 4 rifle magazines. All right. Now, I can tell you that second line kits vary wildly depending on personal preference, on what individuals like to have or feel like they need to have, areas that you're operating in, whether it's urban or rural, and a lot of other factors. So, obviously, if we use law enforcement, for an example, they go out with first and second line gear just like anyone else would. Their first line has everything on their belt and all their utility stuff and everything. Their second line is their vest with all their extra stuff on it. They're not going to be having level 4 plates in their vest most of the time. Most of the time they run around with level 3A. Because it's lighter and more comfortable and it matches the threat of what they carry. Alright, so generally speaking, you want, if you're going to be using armor, you want your armor to match or exceed the caliber firearms that you are carrying on your own. So if you're only going to be carrying pistol calibers, maybe you can get away with 3A. If you're going to be carrying rifle calibers, maybe you can get away with a 3. If you're going to be carrying heavy rifle calibers, probably want to get a 4. All right. Personally, I run a level 4. So we're going to go over some armor levels and classifications and different types before we go over the rest of the vest, just to get those out of the way. So I'm going to grab some of the plates over here. We don't have any examples here of level 2A, 2, or I think straight 3. We don't have a straight 3, but we have some other examples here.
So the National Institute of Justice is the one that comes up with the rating systems. They determine armor ratings based off of how likely it is for a certain projectile to penetrate the armor, alright? Armor is not a guaranteed failsafe. Armor fails, and it has a failure rate, and it needs to pass a certain failure rate to be NIJ certified in that rating, alright? So, just because something's rated for level 3A doesn't mean it won't stop a rifle round. It means it will most likely not stop a rifle round. Meaning like less than 20% of the time it will probably stop a rifle round. But it might. It could. Alright? So, when we're talking about level 2A, which is pretty much the lowest that you would ever want to go, you're talking about it'll stop 22s, 22 Magnum, very simple small things like that, reliably. Alright? Anything else, it might stop a 9mm, probably won't stop a 9mm. 9mm will probably just keep on trucking right through it. Alright? Level 2 is when you start getting into the, it can kind of stop some bigger calibers like 9mm and stuff, but not really. The reliability rating isn't really there, so it's still not recommended for any kind of normal use. When you get into the normal use category, the lowest level of normal use plates or armor is 3A, all right? We have an example of 3A here. This is 3A soft armor. Most 3A comes in soft armor. It's normally not in panels like this. Normally it's in much larger, integrated into a vest of some sort, but 3A is probably the lowest that any individual would want to go, assuming they carry at least a regular 9mm sidearm. It'll stop, it's rated to stop most things up to 40s and 45s, not a 44 Magnum, all right? When you get to a 3, you start to get into the higher caliber and the lowest level of rifle protection. Alright, I have seen soft armor level 3s. They're extremely expensive and they're hard to come by. I think Safe Life is one of the people that makes them, but a bunch of other companies might too, but I'm unfamiliar with too many companies that make soft level 3s. The most common type of level 3 is a plate. So you would get a rifle plate. It's either going to be steel, it's going to be, some of them have like these polymer, synthetic polymer ones. They have like
laminate
plastics and stuff, whatever it is. But once you get to level 3, that's when you can start stopping low-level rifle threats. If I say low-level rifle threats, I mean it'll probably stop a 223, but it probably won't stop a green tip 223, because those are specifically designed to be able to penetrate through hardcover, and all this is enhanced hardcover. All right. So when you're talking about a kit where you're going to be operating in an environment where you're carrying a rifle, you're probably going to be talking about level 4s. Now, level 4s are much thicker. You can see the thickness of a level 4 compared to a 3A. Well, this one's kind of fluffy, so let me squeeze it a little bit so you can actually...
I got the steel one.
Well, you can go ahead and pull out your steel. Your steel's 4 or 3?
3 plus.
So that's another thing that we're going to cover real quick since you mentioned it. The National Institute of Justice does not have a rating for 3+. A lot of companies will develop their own rating systems because they'll design steel plates or other types of plates specifically to counter the 223 and 556 green tips and other high velocity penetrating rounds, but they're not actually tested to be a 3+ or a special threat because there's no Institute of Justice rating for those levels.
The multi-curve build-up coating, level 3+.
So this AR-500, do they give you a rating of what it's good for, or just says 3+?
I think it's on the website. Trigger. It'll take 193 or M193s at 3,100 feet. M855. SS-109 at 31, so pretty much anything going over 3,100 feet.
So the 855 is the green tip.
Yeah.
So it's specifically designed to be able to stop up to the green tip. Once you get into armor-piercing 308s and 30-06s and stuff, the only thing that's going to stop it is level 4s. The scale for the National Institute of Justice stops at level 4, but a lot of companies nowadays, since that rating system is so old, have plate systems that are much more advanced that can far exceed the level 4 specifications. So to meet level 4, all they have to do is be able to stop two AP 30 at 6 rounds, which nowadays is relatively easy for the plates that we have, as long as they're the right kind of plates. The most common plates to do that are ceramic. Ceramic plates are what most people go with because they're relatively light, even though they're thick, and they're inexpensive. You can pick up level 4 ceramic plates for, I've seen them as cheap as $110 a plate. Some places even like $80-$90 a plate, depending on if you get it at the right time of year. The disadvantages of ceramic are that they need to be echo tested every so many years. Each plate has a certain year rating. So this plate, for example, needs to be echo tested every 10 years. Basically what that means is that they want to make sure that inside the ceramic plate, it's not degrading. And as you drop it and move around your plate carrier from place to place and go through temperature changes and everything, the structural integrity of the ceramic inside of it is still intact. That'll make sure that it still has its actual threat level rating. Now you have multi-hit ones, which are similar, but they're designed to be able to take multiple hits in different points of the vest. And some of them are designed to take multiple hits in the same point of the plate. Depending on what they're designed to. Steels, you don't got to worry about that.
Yeah, my ceramics.
Oh yeah, ceramics. Yeah, they're designed to hit at the same spot every time. Some companies have developed patented components to put in their plate systems that allow them to be multi-hit rating for AP rounds still, and they claim to have higher ratings than NIJ level 4 ratings, but again, there is no such thing as a higher than NIJ level 4 rating, even though the plate is probably capable of that. That's the highest certification that the National Institute of Justice can give. Because that's the only thing that the rating system's for. Maybe someday they'll expand the rating system, but for now, that's pretty much as high as it gets. Now, when it comes to the armed forces, they have a completely different rating system that we're not going to go over because we're civilians and we use civilian plates. Okie doke. So, any questions about armor?
Those are level 4 ceramic. They're the multi-hit ones. They're not full ceramic like that one. They're a hybrid between the
those are
plastic. So there's an alloy, it's a plastic, and there's a ceramic in this. And these are the multi-hit level 4 plates. And it's like 3 pounds, 4 pounds versus 10. And I got, there's 4 steel plates in this carrier right now.
Very heavy carrier.
And then the side plates that are in the side here don't drop in weight too much. They're like 6-7 pounds. The mirror safety, they make all this. They have side plates and these. They're all level 4. They don't make anything else. But this will cut your carrier weight down tremendously. And it's multi-hit. Not at the extent your steel plates are, but it'll still take a beating. It can take rounds in the same spot because the way it's made, there's plenty of videos on it. They put 308 AP rounds through it and the 338 fill up. It'll stop it, but I wouldn't.
What's a price comparison between those lighter ones and the sweet
ones? When I bought this, I think I bought it for like $125. You can get the standard level 3 plus plate that's not curved and doesn't have the build-up on it for $95. I think, but that was a couple years ago. You want the bend in it, you want the multi, the build up on it for spalling, and then bending the plate a little bit helps strengthen it. This was $250 for one plate.
Which actually isn't bad for multi-hit rating.
No.
I've seen them go up to $800 per plate.
No, these are great for the protection they give you and the cost that they were. So for $500 I got 2 plates versus all 4 of these were about the same price as 2 plates. The 2 side plates and the front back plate were about the same price as 2 multi-hit level 4s.
So since he brought up the steels, some things that you should know about steel plates if you decide to go the steel route. Yes, they have pretty much an unlimited number of times they can be hit, and they don't have any backface deformation when they're hit, unless you get hit with something really heavy. Backface deformation is how much the back of the plate deforms and then hits you in the chest, breaks ribs, and things like that. However, they have their own risks associated with them, such as spall, which the billet coat can mitigate, but it can't eliminate. And even with other types of mitigation methods, like some people put Kevlar sheets over their steel plates and everything, it'll only stop so much of the spalling. So what happens is, especially if you have a flat plate, not a curved plate, this is sitting right here on you. You're doing your thing, and it takes a hit right here. That bullet doesn't just cease to exist. That bullet explodes into a million little pieces. When it explodes into a million little pieces, they're going to go in every direction. If it hits on the side, maybe it'll deflect off, or if it hits at an angle, but if it hits straight on, it's going to come right up into here, it's going to go into your arms, it's going to go everywhere. It's going to give you a real bad time of things. Which is why, if you're planning on going steel, a build-up coat at the minimum should be a necessity, if not one of them Kevlar sacks that you put on the front of it. It kind of wraps around it all the way. It doesn't add a whole lot of girth to it, but it stops the spalling from being able to go too far. Now, those build-up coats are only good for a few shots. You can see testing on line and everything of them. So although you're not going to be getting holes through this chest, depending on the rating and obviously what you're getting shot with, it's still going to cause its own types of issues. All right, and they're also extremely heavy. We're going to go over weight at the end.
Sounds like spend the extra money and don't get steel.
Yes. So when I first started getting into this kind of gear and stuff, I got steel, and I learned very quickly that steel was terrible. Because when I had my whole kit set up and everything the first time I did it many years ago, I was like, man, this thing's really heavy. And then I would go out, and my wife remembers, I would go out and I would like run around the block several times in the dark after everyone went to bed, and I'd come back and I'd be like, man, this thing's really heavy and it sucks. And that was just like running around for a half hour. Imagine doing this for 12 hours. It'd be terrible. So then I'm like, I need to find a lighter solution. And go figure, ceramics and synthetics and the plastic laminates and stuff, those are all much lighter than the steel, and they provide better protection. So it's better spend the money for a little bit extra. There's some companies that have, like I said, non-ceramic proprietary materials, like Stop Shot, I think, is the one that's out of Stove.
They're probably the best option when it comes to super lightweight and to the technology. They have plates that are pretty expensive, but they'll stop pretty much anything within reason, obviously. But
they're 11 by 14, they're only like 1.5 pounds. It's stupid light.
Yeah, they have their own technology that they have that right now is pretty good. I was going to get them, but spent $500 on two plates, I would have spent like $900 on two plates.
$900? My plate from them would have been $800 a plate.
Oh. There's other ones out there. There's that are thinner than that, yes, that make level 3 pluses, but they're like $1,000 a plate. They're stupid.
Generally speaking, the lighter you get with the higher rating, the more expensive you're getting very quickly. So find out what your budget is, or save up for at least a decent level 4. If, even if you're just going to get a basic ceramic, make sure you go with a reputable company. Don't get something from China. Make sure you get something actually certified by the NIJ. Years and years ago, when I first met the guy that owns that company over in Stowe, he didn't have anything rated by the NIJ because it was a new company, and I met him actually at the range, and we were shooting a bunch of his plates and stuff together, like as a whole group of people that he invited out to test their plates. And I wouldn't touch it with a 10-foot pole because it never went through any kind of rating system. Well, since then, everything's rated and actually performs so well that the first shot from a 30 out of 6 AP didn't have any backface deformation, which is like unheard of. Like, normally backface deformation from a 30 out of 6 AP, you get at least 15, 20 millimeters, but it wasn't even hit. It's pretty ridiculous. So, you get what you pay for.
You can get these on those, like, payment apps and stuff. That's where I got these. I paid $70 a month. And I got them. So if there's are places out there you can find them on, a lot of them will bounce back and forth from those different apps. So you have to download multiple of them to get the gear you need or want. But $70 a month for 6 months, something like that, I got two of them. And then not too long after I bought these, they came out with the side panels, the 6x8s and the 6x6s. And those are all level 4 steel.
So side armor is another thing that's going to be user preference. If you feel like you're going to be going in hot and heavy, like, I don't know why you would want to do that, because it's just a ridiculous thing to be doing. But if you feel like you need that extra layer of protection, that extra armor, they can be useful. But most people shed them for the weight, since all it is extra weight on the sides. If you're very wide like me, they might be useful, because the sides of me make a very easy target presentation. But yeah, it just gives you a little bit extra protection. Save your kidneys and your spine.
And your lungs and whatnot.
Alright, so going into what the... We have another knife. These knives that you have on your actual carrier, if you choose to carry one on your carrier, should be fixed blade, preferably full tang, if not extended tang, and be multi-purpose knives. So, for instance, I went with the SOG SEAL Team Elite for this one. These are pretty hardcore knives, and they keep sharp really well. It doesn't quite fit the profile of a fighting knife, because it doesn't have a pommel, and it doesn't really have a guard, so it's not really designed to be a fighting knife. It's more of a general purpose, all you can do with it knife. So it's more for, you can bust it into a door jamb and snap a door jamb open with it, because it's nice and thick, and it's designed to be able to go under that kind of pressure. Most are like cheap knives from like Walmart or something. You can stick it to a door jamb and twist, and then it'll just snap in half. You don't want to get that kind of knife. You want to get something that you can actually use for all kinds of different purposes that you'll get your life out of. It's used effective life out of. On it, I also have a little multi-tool, just because you never know when you're going to need a multi-tool. You can use multi-tools for all kinds of things. Cutting things, turning things. Multi-tools are just infinitely useful, so I have them in almost everything. Here, I have OC spray, so less than lethal option. If we're operating as civilians, which we are, and it's not an absolute bad day scenario, there's going to be plenty of situations where you might be in a bad situation, and it doesn't necessitate the use of lethal force. So if it's in a situation where you don't want to get into a fist fight with someone, but they're obviously escalating the situation, and you can't de-escalate it no matter how hard you try, you don't always need to escalate it to lethal force. You can diminish them with an OC spray and then avoid the fight altogether. But remember, the only fight that you're ever guaranteed to win is the fight that you never get into in the first place. So preferably, you want to avoid that. But in a situation where you can't, and you're between a rock and a hard place, and maybe something's going on, maybe you're in a crowd of people and they're all acting a mess and they're starting to throw fists and you got to get out of there and you have no means of escape except for to OC some people and get the heck out, it's going to be a good way to do it. OC sprays come in all kinds of shapes and sizes. They got foggers, they got sprays, they got streams, they got gels, they got all kinds of different types of OC spray. So generally speaking, for this type of kit, I would recommend a stream and something that's actually rated to be a good OC spray, not like something that you would pick up at a Walmart or something. If it's for personal use, like you're carrying it in a purse or you're carrying it in your pocket for like daily carry, you're going to want the ones with the extra UV dye in them so that if you do have an assailant or an attacker, the police can identify them later because it gets into their clothes and stuff and you can see who it was. But for this purpose, the stream is the best, in my opinion. It can reach out and touch people at 10, 12 feet away. It's aimable, unlike the actual spray. The spray and the foggers, what you have the issue with is when you deploy them, the wind can bring it back in your face. It can affect everyone in the area and instead of just your intended target. It's a hot mess. So the spray is probably, or the stream is probably the best way to go because it's a concentrated area. You can aim it into their face or chest. You can hit them from 10, 15 feet away sometimes, depending on the type that you have, and not have to get into the thick of it, close quarters with them, where you don't want to be. Unlike the gel just kind of sticks to them. Like if you are 10 feet away and you hit them with the gel and it just sticks to their chest or their chin or something and it didn't get in their eyes, it's not going to do anything. It's just going to irritate their skin a little bit. The spray is going to splash everywhere once it hits them, or the string is going to spray everywhere once it hits them. You don't really need to aim specifically for the eyes, although you do want to hit them somewhere in the face and the chest. Even if you hit them in the chest, it's going to spray everywhere and it's going to get in their eyes anyway. So it'll have the same effect. You just have a larger target area and it's more effective than the gel. Other things that you could have on here, I've had a telescopic baton on here for when you need something less than lethal to get someone out of there or subdue someone or something. You had handcuffs on yours at one point. I know that it's on your other one. So just a means of de-escalating or stopping a bad situation without having to take it to the extremes is what you're looking for some kind of treatment. Some people have cable ties and stuff to do that with. Over here, we have the IFAC, which has much more stuff in it than the BuddyFAC, or the one that you would use on other people and stuff. So, IFACs, we've gone over those in previous classes, tourniquets, Israeli bandages, chest decompression needles, nasal pharyngeal, all that good stuff. It's all in your IFAC. Basically, in case you do take a hit, something goes through your armor, something goes around your armor, bad things are happening, it's to stop you from bleeding out right then and there, as best as possible. Chest seals, things like that. Your other first aid kit is more not to treat extremely life-threatening injuries. It's more about bumps and bruises and stuff, things that you don't really got to worry about. This is more intended for someone to use on you than it is to be used on someone else, like your buddy fat would be. So individualized items, such as your nasal pharyngeal, which need to be measured, it's measured to you because this kit is made to be used on you, not on someone else. That make sense, everyone? Then, in the back, I have an extra backpack attachment on mine. This is where, whenever I go out and stuff, I have a couple cliff bars in there. The water reservoir holds 3 liters of water. You can put water in there. This backpack can hold anything I need for any extra stuff, any mission-specific things. It has a MOLLE attachment to it, so I can attach more things if I need to. If you really needed to, you could probably turn this into your little, maybe 48-hour bag, if it was absolutely necessary and you couldn't get to your third line or something. But this is more just storage space, just in case you need it. I mean, you got all that space back there on your back, why not utilize it, right? Over here on this other side, I got my radio. I got 2 rifle mags on the side. On the front, I got 6 more rifle mags. I got admin pouches up here, which currently contain chem lights. And I had a mirror in here. My mirror's apparently gone missing. I'll have to find it. The mirror, people are always laugh at me whenever I pull out my mirror on the rare occasion that I pull it out and show it to people. But it's actually designed to go on the telescopic baton that I had on here, but you can also put it on anything else. It just clips onto things and it's a little magnetic. You use it to peek around corners and stuff, because why expose yourself fully to something around the corner when you could just grab a mirror and look around the corner if bad things are happening and you don't know what's around that corner? That's my philosophy behind it. I know it wasn't on the list of things, but in my personal experience, it's pretty useful to have. The carrier itself, you want it to be sized to fit you. You don't need to have a carrier necessarily. You can go with a load-bearing vest if you decide to do that. It just won't have the armor or anything. But the whole point of it is to allow you to have everything you need on your person without having to go back to your third line. That's the whole point of having your actual second line carrier. It's mission specific and it's to keep you in the mission. So remember, your first line is for survival. Your second line is for the mission. If the mission is to stay alive and get through a bad situation, then you're going to want the armor. If your mission is just to go out scouting or something, maybe you don't need the armor, maybe you just need a load-bearing vest. But I'm not going to be bringing a load-bearing vest and a plate carrier out with my third line. I'm just going to have a plate carrier that does everything. That's my opinion on it. Now, like I said, this is set up for more universal, multi-purpose roles. Notice how I don't have a tremendous amount of extra gear hanging off of it or all kinds of extra stuff that I don't need. One thing that you learn very quickly when you start actually training these things is that ounces equal pounds and pounds equal pain is a big expression that I hear used all the time with these kind of things, because if you're running around doing all kinds of things for 12, 15 hours in a day and you have all this on weight on you, it builds up really, really, really fast, especially if you're not used to wearing it, moving around with it all the time. A lot of people that are actually prepared to use these kind of kits will do the yard work in them and stuff and do all kinds of things with them just to get used to wearing them and get used to the feel of having them on and get used to the weight on their shoulders and everything, because these things do get heavy, especially if you're using steel plates. But for the most part, there's some other things that you could have on here, like my knife kind of doubles as my entry device, but you can have a pry bar, you can have fire sticks, you can have flares. There's all kinds of things that you could have on here. I used to have a flashlight right here, which I'm probably going to get another flashlight on there, because the reason I got rid of that flashlight is because it turned out there was a crappy flashlight, I haven't bought a new one yet. But you can get all kinds of stuff on here, and you can make this thing weigh 120 pounds. But is that really going to help you at the end of the day? No. A lot of that stuff is going to be mission specific. You're going to keep in your third one. But that's pretty much my vest. Why don't you go over yours? Looks like you have the same backpack on your leg.
Yeah. The only difference really between me and John's is I like to have more ammo. I got 6 up front and I got 9 on the side. We got a little radio pouch here that I don't have my radio in. We got the same backpack on the back. Don't have the water just a minute. And I keep my other side empty, so when I do draw for my pistol, it's not catching on anything, as that happens in a lot of the trainings that we've done. And I have a little gator neck attached to one of the straw things attached down here, tied down. I have multi-tool, and I got a little seat belt there.
All right.
Keys to the handcuffs.
That could be important. All right, so some things to look for when you're looking at building your own second line vest. Good reputable brands. Plate carriers are not all created equal, all right? Different plate carriers have accommodate different size plates. Some of them are only good for the thinner level 3A or 3 plates. Some of them are designed specifically for soft armor. Some of them have integrated soft armor. Some of them are relatively cheaply made and they don't have good drag handles or no drag handles at all, which this one has a nice drag handle integrated into the actual vest itself. The straps, some of the straps, depending on the manufacturer, are like they clip with these cheap little plastic clips instead of actually being integratedly sewn into the vest. Keep in mind that if you have to be pulled from somewhere because you became some type of casualty or you have a problem going on, if this drag handle breaks or these straps break when they're trying to pull you, it's going to be a lot harder for someone to drag you or to carry you or do anything with you. That being said, if something happens and they need to get to your chest to apply first aid, or medical, like it went through, or you had a penetrating round or something, getting trapped in here is not good. So it needs to be able to come off relatively easy as well, which is why Kris has his seatbelt cutter.
Or the buckle right here.
Yeah, it also has buckles and everything.
Pop the one side off.
So those are all things to keep in mind when buying a new vest. You want to go with reputable manufacturers. Don't get something from China. Don't get something that you're not familiar with. Shellback Tactical are good. Condors are good.
With the Warrior Assault System, I forget what this one, this model is actually called. But this plate here specifically is the most popular right now in the world. And it's not expensive really for a mega plate carrier. It's like for $215 8 years ago or so. So it's more expensive now. But, I've never had a problem with it, and it's got enough space on it to do and put anything you want on it.
I have a Spartan gear, or Spartan armor. Legion. Mine's an XL because I, in case you didn't notice, a very large individual. I need to use 11 by 14 plates. Standard plate size is 10 by 12. I use 11 by 14s because of my exceptional size. And my selection of plate carriers was limited because of that. So my first choice would have been probably a Shellback Tactical Banshee Elite 2. And I actually had one of those. And I tried to run the 10 by 12 plates. And in the defensive scenarios that we were running with like airsoft guns and stuff, I kept on getting hit outside the plates because the plate didn't cover anything on me because it was only a 10 by 12. So I went to 11 to 14 and it has a much more coverage on me and I get hit much less outside the plates. I still get hit outside the plates sometimes, but much less. So it's much better in my opinion for me anyway. But that's why I said when it comes to your second line, your carriers and everything, it's going to be very personal preference. What do you need? What do you need to accommodate? And all that good stuff. Now, a couple points to go over after we've gone over everything is that weight. We talked about weight a few times during this whole conversation. Your combined weight of everything, your first, second, and third line gear, should never exceed one third of your body weight. So if you are a small person, you have to really consider what kind of things you're putting in your kits and what kind of things you're taking and what's necessity and not necessity. Now, I weigh 340 something pounds. My kit can weigh almost 120 pounds and still be within that one-third body weight, which mine comes in around 80 something pounds after everything's said and done, including my rucksack that I throw over the back of this to go bug out, bagging and what have you. But if you're a 200-pound dude or 120-pound girl, and you're thinking about building a system, you really got to take that into consideration that if you only got 40 pounds to play with, you ain't going to be rocking a plate carrier with level 4 plates unless they're like super light polymers or ceramics or something. You're not going to be rocking a full bug-out bag kit that's going to last you 4 or 5 days because you're not going to be able to accommodate that kind of weight. You might be able to carry it first. And you might be able to walk down your driveway and be like, oh, this is bearable, it'll work. But mind you, that is not the situation that you're going to be in. You are going to be walking for miles and miles, possibly for days at a time, if a crap hits the fan scenario happens, and that's all you're going to be carrying on your back. So it needs to be something that you can't just bear. It needs to be something that's comfortable for you to wear, and you can operate with it at all times. Obviously, your third line you can stash because it's designed to, but at least your carrier system and your first line, your first and second lines, you're going to want to be able to carry with you comfortably, and it shouldn't affect your dexterity. If this is fitted and sized right, there's specific ways that you fit it on yourself, which we can go over later or individually, but if it's fitted and sized right, you should not notice a significant decrease in your dexterity or your ability to kneel, go prone, stand, go in and out of cover, etc. You shouldn't see any kind of severe detriment in any of that. You might be a little bulkier than normal, so you might catch yourself on things that you wouldn't normally catch yourself on because you're not used to it. The more you wear it, the more you get used to it, but you shouldn't be having a hard time bending over. You shouldn't be having a hard time getting up, things like that. If you're finding that, then you're probably not sized right for your carrier, or the carrier's probably not the best option for you.
Or you have too much crap on.
Or you have too much crap on. I've seen, when we first started doing this, I've seen some people with a whole lot of stuff on their carriers that seemed awfully bulky. And I was like, what are you doing? And over time, they learned real quick after going out for a couple days, doing a crucible or two, and learning real quick that that's not the way that they should have it. We're going to go over the rifles real quick with the slings and such. Any questions? All right. Now, one thing that's going to be in common with your first line and second line systems is going to be your primary firearm and your secondary firearm. Whether your primary firearm is going to be a rifle, such as the AR-15 or AK-47 platform, or a shotgun, such as the Mossberg 590 systems or the Remington 870 systems or what have you, or even DMR systems like the SR-25s, or the Mark 110, which is just the military version of the SR-25, they're all going to be configured differently. And again, that's going to be a lot of user preference. Now, One thing that I wanted to get out of the way with everything here is that everything is unloaded. Everything has a chamber flag except for obviously the pistols, which are locked back. And for some reason, he doesn't have a chamber flag in his, but it's empty. One thing I want to get out of the way first is that a lot of people that I see coming to competitions and shooting classes, especially newer shooters, have way too much stuff on their rifles. If we're going to be talking about rifles, because that's going to be the one-size-fits-all solution to all this, because not everyone's going to be a shotgunner, not everyone's going to have a DMR, but rifles seem to be the one-size-fits-all. So, a lot of people you'll see run all kinds of lasers and all kinds of flashlights and all kinds of extra backup sights and extra red dots, and some of them will have bipods and foregrips and extra grips and back grips and front grips and sideways grips and barricade stops and all this other stuff on there. Some of that stuff is useful and some of the stuff is not useful. And it's all situational, alright? Now again, just like we talked about for the second line gear, ounces equal pounds and pounds equal pain. Now, you don't think about it with your rifle, because you start out with like a 6.5-7 pound rifle, depending on how you build it, and you're like, how much heavier can it get? The answer is a lot heavier, because if you put a bipod on it, well, there's 1.5 pounds. Well, if you put two sets of backup sights on it, well, there's another 0.5 pound. Well, if you put a big optic on it, well, there's another 3 pounds. Well, you put a big stock on it, well, there's another 2.5-3 pounds. And the next thing you know, you went from a 6 pound to 7.5 pound rifle to a 15 pound rifle. And it's just supposed to be for close quarters. That'll make no sense. Alright, so we're going to talk about some different rifle configurations, when they're useful, why they're useful, and what the overall recommendation is. So first and foremost, are you going to use a pistol without a holster? No. So why would you use a rifle without a sling? Right? Does everyone have slings for their rifles? You should, because the rifle is pretty much completely useless without a sling. Alright? Yeah, you can take it out to the range and shoot a little bit. Maybe you can even use it for some home defense. But if you're going to be configuring it in such a way for defense of life and liberty, then you're going to want something to carry it around with and not have to hold it at all times and keep your hands occupied at all times and then drop it and then it hits the ground, because no one likes that. So sling systems, there's two common types of sling systems, and then a couple uncommon types of sling systems. So the two common ones are single point and two point slings. Kris, what's a single point sling?
Well, I don't have one, so they're yours.
Single point sling is a sling that meets at one point. You sling it over, and it will just dangle there wherever you decide to have it hang. It uses the tension against your body and the weight of the rifle, and it will just hang wherever you put it, wherever you need it.
What are the advantages of a single point sling?
Not many. That's why I don't have one anymore.
So single point slings, since they hold closer to your body, are less likely to become entangled on things. Single point slings are, in some respects, easier to use by end users and don't require as much fitment and adjustment, depending on how you do them. Single point slings can be done right, and single point slings can be done wrong. They are a situational type sling. I would not use them for everyday use. I have them because they're good for close quarters and they're good for rapid operations. So if you're going to be going through buildings or things like that, they're going to be a little bit better. But if you're in any other situation, they're going to be much more inconvenient. Yeah, one of the biggest things about single point slings is that when you have it on and you take both hands off the rifle, it dangles. And I don't know if anyone's ever tried to run a course with a dangling rifle, but it hurts your knees, or it slaps you in the side, or it goes all over the place. Worst case scenario is you crouch, the actual muzzle of your rifle goes into the dirt or mud, which I saw happen several times during one of our training scenarios, because they were using a single point sling. Stand back up, Now you got an obstructed muzzle. So if you were to go use that firearm, again, you have a boomstick. Not the good kind of boomstick, but the kind that blows up in your face, which no one wants. It's not what they're supposed to do. All right? Now you can mitigate that with certain muzzle brakes and stuff, but you'd rather not have it to begin with. So single point slings, they serve their purpose. Overall, not recommended for multi-use. Two-point slings. Kris, what's a two-point sling?
A sling that mates at two different points on your rifle. And it will strap across your back and can be pulled tight against your body whenever you're not using it. And it won't dangle, hit you in your knees, stab in the dirt, depending on how you have it slung. And it's still fairly easy to get to if it's strong across your back.
Two-point slings, if you know how to use them properly, can also be used to stabilize your rifle while you're shooting freestanding. I'll put out a good way.
Wrap your arm through it.
So the advantages of a two-point sling are that it holds the firearm closer to your body, it's better retaining, and it doesn't dangle, and it can be used to stabilize. Now that being said, there are slings out there that can convert between two-point and one-point slings. Magpul makes one. Who else makes some?
In my truck.
Oh, yeah, I have one.
I just haven't switched this one out for it yet.
So Magpul makes one. I know there's a couple other companies that do, but I can't think of them offhand. They're good for if you're going to only have one sling to fit all purposes. Because like I said, there's some times where a single point sling is good. There's some times where it's bad. There's most times where a two-point sling is better. And sometimes where it can get snagged on things, and so this is hanging off of you, and it can get snagged on stuff. And when you have your full carrier on, having it go all the way around you and moving around all the time, it can cause a hassle sometimes. But for the most part, two-point slings are the way to go. Now, more uncommon types of slings that are no longer in common use, three-point slings. Has anyone seen a three-point sling?
I kind of have one if you have.
Oh, you kind
of have. Because that HK hook will attach to your...
Yeah, it's a three-point. This is the 2-to-1 sling, converts it from 2-point sling to a 1-point sling.
This is the Magpul one.
Again, dingly, but has its uses. But you can just pop it in, pop it out, because it has two Ds on the actual clip itself. Makes it a little bit more convenient. Now, more uncommon types, like I said, 3-point slings. You don't see them in common use nowadays. I see them every once in a while. Sometimes you see them on law enforcement ARs with the old school A2 style of stock and everything. They're kind of a obsolete thing. I don't really see a good use for them, and I don't really see people running them anymore since there's good reliable two-point slings out. But they do exist, and if it's your thing, you can look into them if you still have an old school A2 AR-15. But with modern stocks and quick detachment points and everything, three-point slings have gone away the dodo bird. So I'm sure there's still some people that use them, but very uncommon. So some rifle components. For the most part, when we're talking about your rifle setup, less is more. Now that being said, there are some things that you can add that add value, and some mission-specific things that are only good in certain situations, but those are things that you might be keeping in your third-line kit instead of actually on your first and second-line rifle, if that makes sense to everyone. So, for instance, notice how neither of my rifles are equipped with a bipod. Does that mean I do not have a bipod? No. I have a bipod for them. I have a bipod for all my guns, because bipods are useful in specific circumstances. But for the most part, if you're just going to be carrying around a rifle all day, It's not something that you're going to be immediately using. Even in a regular engagement, you're probably not going to be utilizing that bipod, and all it's going to do is get in the way. It's going to snag on things. It's going to get stuck in windowsills. It's going to get stuck in car doors. It's going to get stuck everywhere that you don't want it to get stuck. It's another thing hanging off your rifle. Not only that, but it adds weight. And bipods typically add a lot more weight than you think they do unless you get one of the cheap polymer ones. Which, there's nothing wrong with cheap polymer ones. Magpul makes a couple of them. They're not adjustable. They just pop out and they're a specific height. But then they have even more limited use because who's actually the right height to use those if you're going to be going prone? Unless you're going to be shooting off some kind of barricade or obstacle, right? Other accessories. Optics. Some people still run iron sights. Nothing wrong with that. Iron sights are perfectly fine. Optics are much better than iron sights, which is why everyone's using them now, including the armed forces. So what are some advantages of an optic over iron sights?
A better field of view, depending on what one you're hitting. In your LPBOs, you can give a variable zoom on. I like holographic sights, so my rifles have just holographic sights on them. Red dots are a cheaper version of holographic sights, but that doesn't mean they're not useful or anything. I've had red dots until I managed to buy my holographic sight. So they're great, they're good. Just don't buy crap.
Just like anything else that we talk about, you get what you pay for.
What's a holographic sight?
You can pretty much put it wherever you want on the rifle and not roll off. Like this doesn't have to be right there. It could be right here. It's got an unlimited field of view for eye relief.
Eye relief, there you go.
So it could be up here and it's still going to be the same. The dot will look like it's getting bigger until you like adjust to it, so you pull it away or whatever. And it's not really changing. If you put a magnifier behind it, it does not magnify the optic. Your reticle, it'll stay 1 mm away or 2 mm away, whatever you get. So you can't magnify a holographic. Your red dots, if you throw a magnifier behind those and you have a 2 mm away dot, you throw a 3 times magnifier on it, now your dot's 6 mm away. So those are the pros and cons of it.
So the easiest way to classify optic systems is into four different categories, all right? You have what most people colloquially refer to as reflex sights, which is what he's talking about, regular red dots. Typically, they're open face, which means that the laser that goes onto the reflecting surface is open to the elements. Typically, they have infinite eye relief, which means that, like you said, they can be on pistols. You can have them all the way out in front of you. It doesn't matter how far away your head is from it. It's always going to be visible and not have scope shadow or anything because there's no scope. It's just a reflex sight, as they call it. What he's referring to as a holographic sight is an enclosed prism sight. Now, there's different types of prism sights. There's magnified, non-magnified, and some that require eye relief even if they're non-magnified. All right. So his is an enclosed red dot or reflex sight, which is a little bit different than an enclosed prism. The advantage of an enclosed one, especially on a rifle, is that it's not susceptible to the elements. You're not going to get rain inside of the mechanisms, and it's not going to distort the dot. You're not going to have fog build up on the inside of the lenses, so it's not going to distort the dot. And it's going to be compatible with magnifiers. As he said, it's not going to change the size of the dot with the magnifier. It's going to stay consistent, all right? Typically, they're significantly more expensive than conventional reflex sights. But if you're going to be running a rifle, it's recommended to have some kind of an enclosed optic system, not an open optic system. All right. Then you have prism sights. Prism sights, who here has an astigmatism? Some people. If you wear glasses and you have an astigmatism, holographic or red dot sights are not going to be good for you because you're going to get what's called a starburst effect. You're not going to have a nice crisp circle to look at. You're going to have some kind of weird squiggly starburst kind of thing with lines going everywhere. You're gonna be like, what the heck is this? I can't see where the actual target is. Well, then you go into non-magnified prism scopes is what they're called. So you have an actual etched reticle that can be illuminated, and it's a true one times magnification, so it has much more forgiving eye relief, but it still has eye relief. So you still need to worry about where your eye is in relation to the optic itself, which is why on both these rifles that I have equipped with a prism scope and a low power variable optic, which we're going to talk about in a second, I have adjustable length of cone and adjustable length of pull, because you need to have your sight in alignment with the optic itself. If you don't, you're not going to be able to have a consistent hit on target, and you'll have a lot of scope shadow. Scope shadow is that black ring that appears around the reticle of a scope that you can't see the actual reticle because you're coming in at a different angle. So, advantages of reflex sights and enclosed holographic sights is that the battery life on modern ones is ridiculous. There's some of them that last 10 years. Some of them use tritium?
Tritium.
Some of them use tritium, and it's good for years and years and years, and never you need to replace a battery. Eventually, the sight's just going to go bad, but it's probably not going to be in your lifetime.
And the fiber optic?
Some tritium kinds use fiber optics and stuff where it just takes the ambient light. It doesn't create its own light. It just has its own that it takes and then runs down the fiber optic and lights it up. But all of those have their advantages and disadvantages, but the battery life on these new ones, it's like 50,000 hours or something ridiculous, and that's continuous runtime. And a lot of them have shake weight now where they automatically turn on and off when you pick up your gun. So most of the time you can go years without worrying about ever changing out the batteries on those. But they're only good for, I'd say, up to 200 yards, because unless you get a magnifier on them, you can only really see very well out to about 200 yards. The prism scopes, Tregicon makes those really nice prism scopes that can be fixed 3x, 4x, or 6x magnification, the ACOGs. Those are a type of prism scope. This one right here is just a non-magnified prism scope, so it would fulfill the same role as a reflex or a red dot, only really good up to 200 or so yards, except since it has a fully adjustable etched reticle, there's brands out there that you can actually have an elevation adjustment knob on the top with dialable distances. So this one has a bullet drop out to 700 yards. So this one you can actually adjust it to 700 yards and you can see where it is based off of the actual dialing knob itself, so that in case you are lobbing 5.56 rounds at something 700 yards away for some reason, you can actually dial and adjust it. Not that you can see something that far, but you know, it helps a little bit. Then, after reflex, enclosed holographics, and prisms, you get low-powered variable optics, which are these. They have a true 1x magnification setting, which makes it very good for close quarters, but then you can also adjust the magnification, which allows you to engage targets much farther. So just kind of like how this allows you to adjust distances by changing the reticle height, this allows you to engage things up to 8x magnification with a bullet drop compensating reticle, so you can actually see and engage things out to 600, 700, 800 yards. Which, again, I don't know where you're going to be engaging things that distance, but just in case you ever will. Now, you'll also have designated marksman configurations and long range configurations on like 308 ARs, or even on 5.56 ARs designed to use the 77 grain long range projectiles. Those are going to have actual long range scopes. So the bottom zoom setting is going to not be a true 1x magnification. It might be a 3 or a 4 or a 5, or even a 1.5. It's like if it's like a 1.5 to 4 for some reason, if you run one of those. But a lot of people are moving towards the low power variable optics only because they fill such a large role, especially as an individual self-defender. If you're not going to be engaging anything beyond 200 yards, there's absolutely nothing wrong with a red dot or an enclosed holographic. In fact, that's what most people still use, but more and more people are moving towards the LPVOs just for the versatility. Now again, you have to worry about eye relief, even more so than you would with the prism scope, and you have to worry about where your line of sight is in relation to the actual optic itself. But with the extra advantages that it gives you, It could give you a situation where you have the upper hand, or it could allow you to do things that you wouldn't be able to do with another gun. Now, that being said, anytime you use an LPVO or anything with a magnification greater than 3x magnification, it's recommended that you have a set of backup sights or rapid transition sights. So backup sights are kind of different than rapid transitions. This is the prism optic with the 1x magnification. In case something happens to it, it has an issue or anything, it has the backup rifle sights in case it becomes cracked or I need to rip it off real quick for some reason. Notice how they're in line with the optic on top of the rifle. This one, since it has a low power variable optic, has rapid transition sights. So you would slightly turn the rifle to the side and you would still have effective aiming sights out to 50 to 100 yards when you're at a higher magnification rating. It's much faster than changing your magnification. On any rifle that uses an optic system, I highly recommend having some type of backup sight set up on it, because they are battery powered, glass breaks, they can fail, bad things can happen. So no matter what type of backup system that you use, I recommend having some type of backup irons or rapid transition irons. Alright? Now, rifle configurations on their own, they come in a million different shapes and sizes that we're not going to get into specifically, but AR-15s generally, when we're talking about 223s and 5.56s, come in three basic chamberings. The three basic chamberings are 5.56, 223 Remington, and 223 Wild. Alright? Now, 5.56 NATO and 223 Remington have different chamber pressures set by their SAMI specifications and have different actual case lengths. Not projectile lengths, but case lengths set by their SAMI specifications. Which is why most of the time they're interchangeable, but sometimes it can create an unsafe pressure situation when you shoot a 5.56 in a 223 Remington chambered rifle, but not when you shoot a 223 Remington in a 5.56 chambered rifle. Because a 5.56 cartridge, the case itself, is actually designed to have a longer case neck than a 223, and if your 223 is designed to have a shorter throat, which is the point between where the case is and where your rifle engages the bullet, it can actually engage the case neck of the 5.56, basically clamping the bullet in place and causing it to have a catastrophic failure or rapid explosive disassembly of your firearm, which is never a good thing. So it's recommended that you steer away from the 223 Remington chambered ARs, which there's very few of nowadays, and they've mostly been phased out. Go with a 5.56 or a 223 Wild. The 223 Wild, basically, it's a hybrid of the two. It allows you to shoot anything in it safely, but it doesn't sacrifice the accuracy of shooting a 223 in the 5.56. So since the 223 has a shorter case neck, the bullet jumps farther to the lands of your rifling, which can cause inconsistency, which causes accuracy issues. You don't have that in the 223 Wild. You can have 223 Wild to still be stable out to 800, 900 yards if you know how to do it right. I've seen 223 Wild chambered guns shoot out to 1,000 yards. The bullet doesn't have any power then. It's about the same power as a 22, but it'll hit stuff, so there's that. That being said, ammunitions used in these guns, you got the M193, which we talked about earlier. It's the standard 55 grain projectile. You got the M855, which is the 62 grain green tip. And then you got the 262, 77 grain long range. The 77 grain long range one, you're only going to be using it at DMR. It's too slow to have the same devastating effect that you get from 223s and 5.56s on target that you want at close range. But if you're going to be building a DMR style rifle and planning on engaging targets out past 300 yards, you need that extra weight to keep that kinetic energy so that it doesn't turn into a 22 once it hits the target. Does that make sense? You can use M193s or 855s. Both of them are effective in pretty much any 223 Wild or 556 platform. The 855 is obviously designed to penetrate the hardcover, and the M193s are just basic full metal jackets. They tumble a lot out of the 107 twist barrels, which is what gives them their effect on target at close and medium range. So even though they're lighter, they're going faster, they're more unstable coming out of the 107, so they're a little bit more inaccurate, but since they're unstable, when they hit a target, they cause more damage, if that makes sense to anyone. But you can use 193 or 855s, it doesn't really matter. I choose 855s typically, unless I'm running a short barrel rifle of some sort. If it's going to be a short barrel, then you might want to use some specialty loads or something, because you need that velocity in order to get that effect on target. You need at least 10.5 inches to get the speed you need to get that immediate incapacitating effect. Otherwise, as we can see over here, some other accessories, mission-specific ones. We got lights, lasers, any kind of other random stuff like that. It's all good stuff. I have flashlights on a couple of ARs. I don't have any lasers, because lasers are normally only used in conjunction with night vision. If you have night vision, they're great. If you don't have night vision, I don't really understand the use of a laser, to be entirely honest. But that being said, flashlights are always good to have. You don't always want it on at all times, because they'll snag stuff and everything, but you can take them on and off as long as you have a QD one. What are some other things you have in your AR that you'd recommend to people?
Good muzzle device.
Yes.
That'll pretty much reduce your recoil and the flash of your rifle. So if you want the flash taken down when you fire a shot, there are good flash hiders out there. Surefire has good 3- and 4-prong flash hiders. And if you're not worried about flash, you can put a muzzle brake on it. And that'll reduce the felt recoil and muzzle climb of the rifle. I have a muzzle brake on mine, and it almost has no recoil.
So there's different types of muzzle devices too. You mentioned muzzle brakes and flash hiders. There's also compensators and QD systems for suppressors. So this firearm right here has a compensator. It's a muzzle brake as well, but it actually has compensators to the right and the top, so it compensates for recoil up and to the left, since that's the most common direction that rifles on right-handed shooters recoil. So very loud, and they create a large flash, and your gun will definitely shoot a lot flatter and more accurate. This right here is a competition rifle. It's not designed for life or liberty situations or anything, but it definitely shoots very, very flat, and it's very, very accurate. QD systems, such as this one, which is designed to accommodate a suppressor, are typically threaded, either internally or externally, and they can also have an integrated muzzle brake or flash hider. So, for instance, AAC, they make the SD-512 flash hiders or muzzle brakes that take their AAC SD suppressors. You just twist it on, click it a couple times, twist it off. There's dozens of other companies that do the same thing. Silencer Co. Everyone has them. Everyone has them nowadays. But basically, you can buy their proprietary muzzle devices, put them on there, and then suppress it as well, and then take the suppressor on and off. When you have the suppressor off, it acts as a compensator and muzzle brake, which this does both, because it has the top compensator ports and the side muzzle brake ports, and it can also be suppressed by putting the suppressor on. Now, other types, you have what we call pumpkin punchers, which are designed to be an offensive weapon on your muzzle brake, which are kind of silly and I don't really recommend. You might as well just use a bayonet if you're going to run a bayonet. And then you have like the tank brakes, which are extremely recoil-eliminating muzzle brakes. You'll know them because they'll be huge. They'll be larger than your handguard. And then you have breacher brakes, which are designed to be put on a surface, like the mechanism on a doorknob or something. You push it up against the door, and you pull the trigger and it blasts the door out, but it doesn't cause back pressure in your rifle system, so it doesn't cause any damage or catastrophic failures like you would have a blocked muzzle. So those are some other types of muzzle devices that you could find and use if you so choose. But again, a firearm is a tool, and a tool needs to suit the job that it's made for. And depending on the job that you're making your tool for will depend on what types of accessories and components that you put on it. There's millions of things out there that you can do to your AR-15 platform. That's why it's the most popular rifle platform in the United States. And there's no right or wrong answer unless you're using a polymer lower and something 3D printed. So that's pretty much it for rifles, unless you have something to add.
I think I have to go for buttstocks. A little more than...
Yeah, we could go for buttstocks.
Some of them have your standard, well, not with that one, your standard mil-spec buttstock.
Like an A2?
Yeah, you just throw that away and buy something better. I got a SOP mod, and it's got two little tubes on the side, and I keep batteries in the tubes for my sight and my flashlight because they take the same battery. And the wrong tube. One of them has batteries in it. There they are. There's my batteries.
Where's the flashlight?
For a flashlight and my Vortex.
Spare batteries are always a convenient thing to keep on there. You can sometimes keep stuff in your grip too, depending on the type of configuration.
There's three in there right now. I could probably easily get five or six on both sides. And then charging handles. There's nothing really wrong with the standard one that comes with this, but almost nobody does the two-finger thing like this. So you should get an enhanced one that's on the one side and grab that. I don't know anybody that does this anymore.
Depends. If you got to mortar it.
You can still do that with this.
Yeah.
Then I can just put my foot on it.
Then you torque it.
Triggers. You always put a better trigger in it. I got a single stage flat face 3.5 pound trigger in mine.
What's a single stage mean, Kris?
If there's one wall. It's just one break. There's no
creep.
Yeah.
So
it's pretty light. It'll sneak up on you.
I use the 3.5 pound triggers in my guns too. I don't use the flat face, I use the curved trigger, like standard classic. I mean, if we're going to talk about those kinds of accessories and creature comforts, I like ambidextrous charging handles, only because you never know when you're going to need them. And why not? I like the Radium Raptors. I have them in most of them, and then I have a couple of Beer Creeks, I think. And then on my competition rifles, I do have barricade stops, because you kind of need them in competition. Like if you're going to be shooting something very small, very far away, it's really nice to be able to stabilize your rifle on any surface that you can possibly find. But for regular Life and Liberty guns, I don't see a point to it. It's just another thing to snag onto a surface. If you have a full rail system or a quad rail, rail covers are really nice. They stop you from getting cut. I have rail covers on all of my excess top rails that are sharp and pointy and will make you bleed if you run a raw finger against them, which hopefully you're wearing gloves, but if you do, then they're very sharp and inconvenient. My stocks, like I said, since I'm running actual prism scopes and LPVOs, are all fully adjustable comb and length of pull, and these are skeletonized Luth AR stocks, but I have other ones too. Like on my DMR, I have Magpul PRS, which is much, much, much heavier, but it's much more consistent and a lot better. You know, like I said, it all depends on your preference. We can go all day about all kinds of different accessories, but for the most part, the big thing is, if you're going to take away anything from this class, don't put too much stuff on your rifle. You only need so many things, and there's a lot of things that you might think you need and think look cool, but they're really mission-specific items that are good to have. They're just not good to keep on at all times. Like, I have AR in the house that has a flashlight on it because at all times, because it's specifically for taking care of critters in the backyard whenever there's critters in the backyard, which is most of the time at night. So that keeps a flashlight at all times. Everything else, I can take and remove a flashlight on it as needed. And you have extra rails and stuff for that just in case. You got a rail for the bipod. Just mount that rail so that when you need it, you just clap it on with a QD system. But that's pretty much all I got for rifles. You want to go to pistols?
Yeah, what a few things are there.
There's a few things that go into pistols. Like optics versus no optics, lights versus no lights.
I have no optics on mine because really careful optics on a pistol. But all of them do have flashlights and they all have night sights on them. I keep the same flashlights on both of them. And they're 1,000 lumen flashlights. And they have a strobe on them too. I like the suppressor height sights. Because then if you do have one hand, you can still drop the gun with the rear sight or off the back of your boot or your pocket or whatever it's going to catch onto. You can charge your pistol.
So,
and obviously I don't call.
The red dots, optics on pistols. There's been a lot of debate about that over the past 5 to 8 years. It wasn't very good 8 years ago. Optic systems that were developed for pistols 8 years ago were unreliable at best. They had a lot of battery issues. They had a lot of exposure to the element issues. Some of them had recoil issues where they would just crap out because of the recoil and everything, and a good one would cost you $800 just for a good one on your pistol. That's not the case anymore. I was never a big advocate of pistol optics until maybe a year and a half ago, 2 years ago, when they started to come out with the actual affordable, good, reliable pistol optics. Now, if you've been using iron sights and you have 100,000 rounds downrange with iron sights, a red dot's not going to do anything for you that you haven't already done with iron sights. If you're a relatively new shooter and you haven't gotten into investing into iron sights and learning how to shoot on the iron sights and everything or on the red dot, you can go either way. But I can tell you that red dots, they change the way you shoot a pistol, which is why they're becoming more and more popular in the armed forces and law enforcement and competition shooting world. They change your sight focus from focusing on your front sight, which causes you to have two planes of vision. You have your plane of vision going straight down your sights into your target, and then you have the other one coming across your front sight and not looking at your target, which inevitably causes you to lose situational awareness with this eye and makes it so that you can't be threat focused, you have to be sight focused. Red dots, since they have only one plane that you're focusing on, and they have infinite eye relief, they allow you to look through the sight instead of at it, so that you can be threat-focused instead of sight-focused, which gives you situational awareness benefits, and it gives you accuracy benefits, because obviously you have a more pinpoint area that you're going to be shooting at that's free-floating. So you have a larger field of view with your optic, and you have more situational awareness. Now, that being said, for most people that are going to be using a firearm in a defensive situation, it's only going to benefit you if the target is more than 7 yards away. If you're going to be using a firearm in a defensive situation and you're just going to be drawing and shooting with barely acquiring your sights, yes, you might be able to do it faster with a red dot, but if the target is that close, you should be able to instinctively fire on it anyway, if you're practicing enough and shooting monthly like you should be. If you're not shooting monthly like you should be, and you're not utilizing that firearm at all the times that you should be, and getting the training in that you need, you might be able to benefit from a red dot, but you have to remember that red dots require training too. They're not just an end-all be-all. You can't just pull the gun up and expect to see that dot. When you pull that gun up, if you're unfamiliar with your firearm and don't hold it at the right angle, you're going to be fishing for that dot, just like you would be trying to line up those sights. So it's all about putting those rounds down range. Once you put those rounds down range, there is noticeable and measurable advantages to a dot system when it comes to speed and accuracy. Like I said, which is why a lot of competition shooters and everything are moving more. But when it comes to defensive shooting, more and more people are using them on their defense handguns too, because it has those advantages. But if you're going to do that, co-witness iron sights with it, because they still can fail. They still can become foggy. You can't pick up the dot if the sun's at the right angle. If it's raining, the dot's all over the place because now your optic's wet. All kinds of things can happen. I started carrying with a red dot not too long ago. Last year, I got a new carry gun with a dot on it, and I started playing around with dots more. But I was never a huge advocate of dots until they came out with those new ones that have the 50,000 hour battery life and the solar power and the shape weight and all these other things that allow it to actually be useful. And I can tell you that they are much more accurate. They allow you to acquire your sights much faster, and they allow you to focus on that threat. But there have been plenty of situations where I draw that gun at Wednesday night steel or something, and the sun's at just the right angle, and you can't see anything. Or it's just a little foggy out, so you can't see the dot. Or it's just a little rainy out, so the dot's all over the holographic. So it does happen, and I'm sure in a real-life defensive situation it's going to happen too. So that's why my carry gun now has the co-witness iron sights with the red dot. I mean, it's a lower third co-witness, it's not a full co-witness, so that in case I can't acquire the dot, I just look a little bit more up on the gun and I can see my iron sights. But it is something worth looking into if you have the cash for it and you have the desire to do it. If you're someone that has eye problems, no one has an astigmatism, you're not going to be able to use it effectively unless you get like a huge 6 MOA or 7 MOA dot or something. Like the one that I have on my defensive gun right now is a 6 MOA because I need it because I have an astigmatism. But for close range, that should be all you need. Other than that, there's nothing wrong with having a light on a gun. I got lights on a couple guns. I use them at night just in case. Carry gun. Maybe I wouldn't do it on a carry gun, only because you need to know that you're under immediate threat to deploy a carry gun anyway, and target identification is very important in that. And so you're like, well, then why don't you recommend a flashlight? Well, because if you're pointing your light at something to identify it, then you're already pointing a loaded firearm at it to identify it. If it's in your house, that's fine, but if it's your carry gun, you should be identifying it without having to point a gun at it first before determining it's a threat. That makes sense to anyone. But that's just my opinion on it. The biggest thing to think about when you're talking about guns on your first and second line kit is you want something with good capacity, because if you're going to be running your first and second line, your primary firearm is what you're going to be fighting with. The only time you're going to be using your secondary is to fight back to your primary. Maybe your primary goes down. Maybe it jams. Maybe you run out of ammo for it, something else happens. You're only pulling your secondary because something bad has happened to your primary. So your secondary isn't going to need to be something that you need to absolutely 100% rely on, but it should be good enough to get you out of a bad situation. And it needs to be reliable, it needs to have good capacity. Hopefully you won't need to reload with it, because if you need to reload with it, then you got bigger problems. And you always want to carry extra mag with it just in case you do have to reload with it, but full-size guns in level 2 or 3 holsters, because they're going to be out the waistband carried and not concealed. Completely different requirements than what you would be using for your concealed carry gun. Alright, you got anything to add about pistols? We can go over ammo. So, what you train with is not going to be what you load for a defensive situation. 115 grain ball ammo, or full metal jackets, like most people call them. 147 grain, high-tech poly coats, things like that that you train with and compete with. Those aren't going to be what you're going to be loading into your Life and Liberty pistols or your self-defense pistols. You're going to be loading hollow points, preferably bonded hollow points, preferably high-velocity bonded hollow points. If you have a gun that can take plus P ammo, use plus P. If you don't have a gun that can take plus P, buy a gun that can take plus P, because that means your gun is junk anyway. You want, for your Life and Liberty one, since you're going to be using a 4-inch to 5-inch barrel, you can use pretty much any standard self-defense 124 grain, 147 grain, bonded hollow points. They'll come out of there moving fast enough to expand, put all their energy in the target, neutralize that threat. If you're using a micro carry, subcompact, or compact pistol with a barrel length anywhere from 3 inches to 4 inches, somewhere in that range, you're going to be wanting to use a specialty compact or subcompact ammunition. A regular 124 grain HST that's not designed to go through a 3.5-inch barrel is not going to reach sufficient velocity to expand properly on impact. And it's not going to have the effect on target that you want. It'll still hopefully stop the bad guy. Hopefully. It'll still hopefully neutralize the threat. But it's not going to have that immediate punch and stopping power that it would if it expanded. Because since it won't expand, it's going to be creating a small wound cavity that might not hit anything important, and the bad guy can keep fighting you. When we're talking about expansion and permanent damage, you need at least 1,100 feet per second. Some projectiles can do it in 1,000 to 1,050, but generally, you want at least that speed in order to properly expand that projectile in that target, and you're not going to get that out of a 3-inch barrel unless you use something special like Spear makes 124 grain micro carry round specifically for short barrel pistols that allows that projectile to expand properly. For most of my service guns and my duty guns, I use Federal HST Law Enforcement. It's a really good high performing round. I would not use that in my carry gun, which is only a 3.5-inch barrel, because it will not properly expand. For that, I use Spirit Gold Dot Micro Carry. So, that's something to keep in mind. If you're carrying a full-size gun concealed, that's great. If not, get something that will actually work in it. But for your Life and Liberty guns, load them up with something reliable, bonded hollow point, Federal HST, Hornady Critical Defense, Remington Golden Sabers, Winchester PDX Defender Plus Ps, things like that. Those will all work and be reliable rounds. Test them in your guns, obviously. Not all guns are created equal. Some guns like some animals more than others. But for the most part, any of those will be effective. Stop covering everything. So, that being said, let me bring back out my notes. Alright. So, we talked about the three lines of gear for Life and Liberty situations, shit hits the fan situations, all that good stuff. Let's talk about it in everyday life. So obviously in everyday life, you're not going to be carrying around a plate carrier. Unless it's in your car, which you probably should. If it's in your car, that's fine. But it's probably not going to be on your person, and you're probably not going to be carrying around a rifle slung around while you're shopping at Walmart or something. I mean, you could. Technically it's legal, but they're probably going to ask you to leave. So, everyday carry is what we think about when we think of our first line everyday life. We already practice it and we already do it every day. We just never think of it in the lines of requirements that we put our tactical gear into. So when we talk about it, what's some things that you never leave the home with without every day?
Your phone.
That's phone? What else?
Your purse.
If you're a lady, your purse.
Chapstick.
If you're a dude, it's your wallet.
Flashlight, knife.
Flashlight.
Chapstick.
Knife. Keys.
Wallet. Your clothes.
Wallet.
The carry gun.
Carry gun. Basic stuff, right? So, as a regular self-defender, you've already been practicing the first line in everyday life without even noticing it. Like everyone carries around their knife. I could pull out of my pocket. Everyone carries around their carry gun. Everyone carries around their wallet, their keys, their phone. They always have a communication device. They always have a cutting device. They always have a defensive device. It's a normal thing in everyday life that we just don't think about as being integral to levels of gear or requirements. A second line is something that we've talked about before, but never really thought about it in the lines. What do we think a second line might look like for an everyday life? Remember, first line is about survival, second line is about the mission, and third line is about continually being on the field. So some everyday life things for the second line.
You like a bug out bag?
It could be a day bag. Brian said it a bunch of times. Something you just carry around in your car or carry around with you. You can shop around with it, you can keep it. It could be a fanny pack. Who knows? But it contains some things such as water bottles, warm clothing or rain clothing depending on your climate, a basic first aid kit, maybe a couple energy bars, some basic food, some spare batteries with some stuff that you might have, and just very basic supplies. It's not your bug out bag. It's not your tactical gear bag. It's just some stuff that you might need. We're going through, well, right now it seems like we're still in summertime, but we're in the middle of winter in Northeast Ohio. You think you should have some warm blankets in your car?
Oh, yeah.
You think you should have a rucksack with some basic emergency supplies, maybe some flares or a tow hook or something? Those are some things that you should have in your car. Third line, when it applies to everyday and everyday life, is probably going to be something that you carry in your vehicle, not on your person. It's going to be something like we just talked about, a blanket, an extra emergency lamp, emergency flares, maybe a safety vest if you're stranded on the side of the road, tarps, basic tools, food, spare clothes. It's very situationally specific for your climate, but it's long-term survival stuff in case you get stranded somewhere. Now, the chances of you getting stranded somewhere are very slim, but we talk about it all the time about how we're going to use our bug-out bags to bug out somewhere. Why not think about it in everyday life of what we're going to have in our car all the time in case we got a boogie in our car somewhere, right? I mean, what's wrong with having an extra AR pistol behind the back seat? You never know when you're going to need it. So, those are some ways that you can apply to everyday life. And when you're talking about your carry gun and other things that you carry on you, make it a part of your everyday morning routine if it isn't already part of your everyday morning routine. Every day when you get up, you do all your normal morning routine stuff, and then you leave for work. Even if your work doesn't allow you to have those kind of things, in Ohio, they're required to let you have it in your car. So even if you're not carrying it with you at work, legally in Ohio, they're required to let you have it in your car, locked in your glove box or something. So there's no reason not to carry it to and from work and then keeping it secured in a vehicle, even if it can't be on your person at all times. So, for years, a long time ago, I never used to carry to work because they didn't allow it, and if I ever got caught with it in my car, it would be a big deal. But then Ohio passed that law, and ever since then, you can guarantee I have guns in my car, because you never know what's going on. It's a crazy world out there nowadays. I mean, if you don't have a way to defend yourself, you're relying on the police to save you, and as we've seen in some recent events, there's some not very good cops out there that'll more than likely just watch things happen to you rather than help you. Don't get me wrong, there's a lot of good cops out there. They're more than willing to lay themselves down for the people like they should, but there's been at least 4 or 5 instances in the past few years, and we all know what I'm talking about, where cops just watch things happen and don't step in and do anything about it. And you don't want to be the one waiting for someone to do something about it when they don't care to do anything about it. But,
Well, that's all. The other day, my granddaughter, we're getting ready to leave the house, in the bedroom, tucking my pistol in my pants. Maybe we're going to the store. What do you need that for? You never know. What do you mean you never know? I said, okay, for instance, a couple months ago, those people in New York that were shot in a parking lot and in a grocery store. Do you think they expected to be shot going into the grocery store? No. I said, that's why. Well, what if that has this? I'm taking some people down with me. You know? So I just had to explain, what would you need that? That's what you need that for. Because you just don't know.
Like I said, especially in the world we live in nowadays, stuff's happening all the time. Seems like every time you turn around, there's something else on the news. It's ridiculous. The whole country's falling apart. But that's why we're here. And we've been noticing that for the past couple of years. And that's why we're a preparedness group, to be prepared for those kind of things. But unless you have anything else to add, that's pretty much all I have for the gear class. We can go into some more details if you wanted to on the chat and everything. And you can ask me specific questions, and I'll answer them as best as I can. But it was a bunch of requests that people wanted to know what kind of gear we were using, what we recommended, and everything. So that we put something together and show it to everyone. And we knew it would be a time-consuming one because there's a lot of stuff to go over, but talking in as much generalities as we can, we tried to keep it under a few hours. So thank you all for coming today, and thanks for watching the video if you're online. Have a good one.